which I generally start with. So this sixth semester, you're going to have this practical by name called as molecular biology. Are you able to see? Yeah. Now is it clear, seen to you? Yes. So the paper is seventh paper, practical molecular biology. So the syllabus or the contents of this paper, let us first see what it is. The code for the paper is BC. BC is biochemistry 634, sixth semester. And for biochemistry, it is 34. P stands for practical. Now, the practical classes per week will be two, only 2 hours. Then it's a third year, sixth semester, and number of credits for this practical session is only one. So these are the list of experiments which you have to or which you're supposed to do for this particular semester, that is separation of purines and pyrimidines by paper chromatography. We know that paper chromatography is the simplest of all the chromatography techniques, but still it is one of the important technique where some pilot studies of various experiments are being generally done. So it gives a very good understanding about the principle, like how we are trying to exploit certain properties of the biomolecules, which can be used to separate them from the complex components. Okay. The next one is isolation of DNA. So there are various sources for the isolation of DNA. As per your syllabus, they have given onion, liver, or coconut endosperm. So I generally prefer to do with onion because we have two simple procedures where within one day you can isolate it and you can visibly see the DNA also. So by using this onion, you cut it, you dice it, you grind it, you add the extracting buffers to it, you use ethanol, ice cold ethanol. So there are important steps in the procedure with which you can isolate the DNA. So if onion is not there, you can do with the liver sample also, but it is a long procedure. So within 2 hours we have to complete the experiment, so that's why we go with onion. Here also I will show you two different protocols in order to isolate the DNA from onion. Same experiment can be done even for a coconut endosperm. So since I do generally with onion, some of the final years in few years back, they said, ma'am, why don't we try with coconut endosperm? I told, I don't have a protocol for it. You can get the protocol. So they got the protocol and they did that experiment also once and checked out whether they're able to isolate the DNA. So when we are doing this procedure, actually you can see the white color DNA strands which are coming out from the onion extract. So by seeing that, you will be able to tell that yes, you got the DNA. But just visually seeing the strands of DNA, if I say this is the DNA, some of them may not get convinced. So what I do, the next thing is the isolated DNA, whatever we are getting it, I pull it into a Eppendorf tube. After pulling it, I will dissolve the DNA in the saline citrate buffer solution. After doing that one, I will take its absorption maxima. If it is DNA, the sample should show the maximum absorbance at 260 nanometer. So if it is showing the absorbance at 260 nanometer, then what is the substance we have isolated? What is the biomolecule we have isolated? We have isolated the DNA. This is one thing what we can do. Second thing what you can do with your isolated DNA sample, you want to check the purity of your sample. Because when you want to go to the advanced step, if you want to go for the next level of research, the purity of your sample is very, very important. So how much pure it is? So the isolated DNA, you're going to check the purity by using UV visible spectrophotometer. So you, by using a ratio 260 by 280, you find out the ratio, whether it's 1.8 or 2, and depending on your result, you can tell by how much pure is it your DNA sample. What can, when I say that your DNA is pure or impure, then what can be the impurity? The impurity can be the proteins which will be present in, along with the DNA. Because it is onion, and we know that onion will be the eukaryotic cell. So the chromosomes will be associated with the proteins like histones, so they can be present along with the isolated DNA. So the purity of your sample will change. So you can isolate the DNA, confirm it by DPA method or by absorbance at 260 nanometer, check the purity of your DNA by using UV visible spectrophotometer, and depending on all these results, you can go for agarose gel electrophoresis to approximately tell what is the molecular weight of your isolated DNA. So the experiment is very simple, like isolation of DNA, but I am going to connect this experiment with various other experiments also. That is what you can think about. One experiment, how can you link it and make it useful for your other experiments? In the point of research view, if you want, how you can convert one experiment and add on the other experiments to get a clear idea about what are you working on with. Okay. Similarly, we have the third experiment, isolation of chromosomal DNA from E. coli cells. So this is actually with a kit. We generally do it. So we take the E. coli cells. That's also a long procedure. We have 2-3 steps of centrifugation, and it must be in under ice cold conditions to isolate it. So here also, after isolating, once you get the pellet, you can check the purity of your isolated DNA. You can check whether it is concentration by using DPA method. You can also perform electrophoresis to determine the molecular weight of the isolated DNA. So the next experiment is determination of purity of nucleic acids by UV visible spectrophotometric method. So we have we prepare some standard solutions, and isolated DNA will be considered as your unknown solution, because standard solutions, all the DNA and RNA are going to be commercially available to us. So we have to prepare with a particular concentration, and we have to take the absorbance. One will be at 260, the other reading will be at 280. So you have to divide it, find the ratio. And depending on the ratio, you come to a conclusion how far is your nucleic acid, that is DNA or RNA, going to be pure. Then estimation of DNA by DPA method or diphenylamine method. This is your major experiment. Then estimation of RNA by arsenol method. These two are very common general methods which we generally use in order to quantitatively estimate the concentration of these nucleic acids. Then estimation of DNA and RNA by spectrophotometric method. These two are colorimetric methods. Just by adding the substance, getting the reaction, the colored product will be formed, and based on the color intensity, you are determining the concentration. But in the case of spectrophotometric method, you are also able to calculate its concentration. So we have a small equation. So whatever solutions you are taking, you have to just take their absorbance in the UV region, and then with that equation, with whatever absorbance you got for that particular concentration, you're going to calculate it. Okay. The next one is agarose gel electrophoresis of the nucleic acids and visualization by methylene blue staining. In the previous semester, you had restriction digestion and agarose gel electrophoresis. So both the things we combined together, and we have done it. So, but here it is only agarose gel electrophoresis, and the detecting agent is going to be methylene blue staining. We are not going to use here ethidium bromide. So two different detecting agents are there, ethidium bromide or methylene blue staining. Because ethidium bromide is highly carcinogenic, we can do even with methylene blue staining. It also will show you the bands. Then the next to last experiment is effect of temperature and ionic strength on the DNA. So the last experiment is effect of temperature and ionic strength on the DNA. So we are going to take the DNA and you're going to expose it to various set of temperature starting from 20, 30, 40, 45, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, or 100 degrees centigrade. Now what will happen at all these temperatures? When you are going above certain temperature, the DNA can undergo denaturation. So if your DNA is double stranded DNA, the hydrogen bonds will be broken, double stranded will become into the single stranded DNA. So that is the effect of temperature. Similarly, ionic strength. So you are preparing the salt solution of different concentrations. You can add it on the DNA solution and check out what is happening to the DNA molecule, because there is lot of effect of the temperature and the ionic concentration on the DNA. So by plotting a graph, by seeing the graph curve, you can come to a conclusion what has happened to your double-stranded DNA molecule. So these are the list of experiments for this particular semester. Okay, so out of these all, these are the two important major experiments, because they both are colorimetric estimations, but others all are only like group or demo experiments. If everything is fine and we are going to do it, then this can be made as an individual experiment, but others has to be done only in the form of groups. That means one batch will be divided into two or three or four groups and you will be doing it. Okay. So we are going to discuss about the first experiment. It's the simplest of all, and since you have been studying this technique topics from your previous semester, that is your fourth of whatever semester, I think you must be able to understand more about this particular experiment. So aim is to separate purines and pyrimidines by paper chromatography. They both are the nitrogenous bases which are present on the nucleic acids, either DNA or it can be the RNA molecule. So their molecular weight is too low, so you can make paper chromatography as one of the experiment in order to separate them. Now this particular purines and pyrimidines, you can ask me what is the need for us to use paper chromatography in order to separate the purines and pyrimidines. It's very simple, students. You're taking a nucleic acid, say the DNA or RNA, you're treating with some enzyme. What will be the product you're going to get? Some of the products what you will be getting are some purines and some of the pyrimidines. So what type of purine, what type of pyrimidine has been obtained, you can separate them on the paper chromatography and you can observe them. Because purines, you know, they have a high molecular weight because they have two rings within them. Pyrimidines, they have only one single ring within them. So the molecular weight is also different. So you can use as a pilot and error method just to detect the presence of the purine and the pyrimidine bases in your given sample. So coming to the principle of your experiment. So the first point is that nitrogenous bases are separated based on their partition or distribution coefficient between the liquid stationary phase. Where is the liquid stationary phase? That is the water held on the chromatographic paper, and the liquid mobile phase. So in the case of paper chromatography, it is liquid chromatography, because the phases what you are using is a stationary phase, which is a liquid, and also another liquid, that is the mobile phase. Now as we have discussed earlier also, that even though we are using paper for the stationary phase, paper is never going to be the stationary phase directly, because paper is prepared with cellulose. So cellulose will be having the hydroxyl groups, and many of these hydroxyl groups will be hydrogen bonded with water, which will be seen in the form of moisture on the paper. So that is the water present on the paper which is going to act as the stationary phase. So paper is going to only act as a supporting material. Okay, and the mobile phase what we are going to use again is a different mixture of the solvents. So the mobile phase is also a liquid phase. Now, as the mobile phase is moving along the stationary phase, those nitrogenous bases that have high affinity for stationary phase and least affinity for the mobile phase will be retarded. So again, I am telling, even if you take a nitrogenous base that is having high affinity towards the stationary phase, then their movement will be retarded. Whereas those nitrogenous bases that have high affinity for mobile phase and least affinity for the stationary phase are carried along or are moved along with the mobile phase, and they remain stationary once when they reach their respective RF values. So depending on the affinity, if the sample, if your nitrogenous base is having high affinity towards the stationary phase, its movement will be retarded. Whereas when you take the nitrogenous base, if it is having more affinity towards the mobile phase, then it will move with the speed of the mobile phase and it will get separated. So this is the property what we are exploiting on the nitrogenous bases in order to separate them. So as you know the protocol, so this is the principle of your experiment. So as you know the protocol, you take the Wattmann filter paper, you cut it according to the required dimensions, then you spot your sample, then you place it into the chromatographic chamber. Once it is over, then you're going to remove the paper, you're going to detect the presence. So how you detect the nitrogenous bases? These are all the viva questions which can be asked for you. After completion of the chromatographic run, the chromatogram, we don't say it as again Wattmann filter paper, because after the experiment is over, we call it as a chromatogram, is going to be visualized by using the UV trans illuminator. So this is the important point everybody should keep in mind, because if it is amino acids, you specifically add the ninhydrant reagent, heat your paper, then you observe the purple color for the detection. But in the case of nitrogenous bases, after they have got separated, you have to take out the chromatogram, dry the chromatogram and put it under the UV trans illuminator. If there is your sample nitrogenous base, then you are going to observe the black color spots as your indicator or the location of your nitrogenous base in the UV trans illuminator. So that tells to you that your sample has been separated. So what is the phenomena over here? We know that these are all nitrogenous bases: adenine, guanine, cytosine, uracil and thymine. They all are having two ring systems with nitrogen atom within them. So they will be having the absorption at the particular wavelengths, okay? That is in the UV region. So that is why DNA also, you are telling that its absorption maxima is at 260, because adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine, all these four nitrogenous bases, because of their ring system, they all are going to have the absorption only in the UV region. So that's the reason why, to locate the presence of these nitrogenous bases, we are going to take the chromatogram and view it under the UV trans illuminator. Because they can absorb that particular light, they will be showing you the black color spot. So once you have observed the spot, the separated nitrogenous bases present in the samples will be later identified based on the standards which you have going to spot it on the paper. Okay, so these are the points what you have to remember and keep in mind for the principle of paper chromatography. What are the next requirements? So the first requirement is the set of the chemicals or the reagents which we are going to use for this experiment. So the first thing what we require is 70% perchloric acid solution. So this solution we have to prepare it, and this is the solution with which you are going to dissolve your nitrogenous bases, because they all are aromatic ring system containing bases. So they will not get easily solubilized in the normal water what you are going to add. So that is why we are dissolving these nitrogenous bases only with the perchloric acid solution. So we first prepare the stock standard nitrogenous base solution. So you can take any of these type of the bases as your sample. Now the concentration which you are preparing this particular nitrogenous stock will be 10 milligram per ml. So once you have prepared the stock solution, then you are going to prepare the working standard nitrogenous base solution. So what we do from the stock solution, you are going to pipette out or take 0.1 ml of the stock and dilute it to 1 ml with 70% perchloric acid solution. Once you have prepared this working standard, then the concentration will get decreased to 1 milligram per ml. So this is how you prepare the standard nitrogenous base solution. So once you have prepared the standard solution, the next one what you have to be ready with is the mobile phase. So what is a mobile phase you are using for separation of purines and pyrimidines per paper chromatography? This is a very good mobile phase what we can use. One is isopropanol, then water, then concentrated HCl, which must be in the ratio of 13 ml of isopropanol, 3.7 ml of water, and 3.3 ml of concentrated HCl. So this is the mobile phase what we are going to use for the paper chromatography. So as we have said earlier, this mobile phase what we are using also should have certain properties. So it should be a mixture of the organic solvents or an acid or a base. So you have here one solvent and an acid which is mixed with a particular proportion, and they are also supposed to undergo rate of vaporization, where they will all vaporize or evaporate with a particular capacity, so that when you keep the chambers for saturation with the mobile phase, they all will evaporate at the same time, so that the vapors which are present inside the chromatographic chamber will be having all the solvents in a proper proportion, which will enhance the separation to take place properly. So these are the chemicals and reagents. Other than this, we require even various other materials also. One is Wattmann filter paper. Then we require the gloves. So because we cannot directly use our hands, bare hands for the Wattmann filter paper, they can be used for other experiments also. So it's better that we always handle it with care. So you can use the gloves to wear it and handle the paper. Use the pencil and scale according to the dimensions required for your chromatographic chamber. You can measure the length, height, everything, and you can use a pencil and scale and draw this size on the paper, and you can cut it with the scissors. Once it is been done, then you can start with your experiment. Then other requirements are capillary tubes or micro pipettes. You may require some glass pipettes, then measuring cylinders, glass beakers, and the UV lamp which is present in the trans illuminator. Now coming to the procedure. So the first step in the procedure is paper, that is a Wattmann filter paper. How are you going to prepare the Wattmann filter paper? The first thing what you do is cut the Wattmann filter paper to the required dimensions. So when you are using the paper, as I told you, handle the paper with the disposable gloves only. Okay, so here for this particular experiment, we are going to not use a beaker for the separation. We are going to use only the measuring cylinder. Okay, so 500 ml measuring cylinder, we are going to take it, and that is going to be the chromatographic chamber with which we are going to perform the experiment. So once you have cut the paper according to the required dimensions, next thing what we are going to do is that we are going to draw a line about 1 to 1.5 centimeter parallel to one end of the paper, and that line what you have drawn denotes the origin. Then make markings on the origin at equidistance depending on the number of samples to be spotted. Since it is a measuring cylinder, maybe only one or two samples you may be able to spot it. Okay, so since we don't have the unknown nitrogenous bases samples, we are going to spot only the standard solutions like adenine, guanine, cytosine, uracil, or thymine, whatever we are preparing, that only will be kept as a spot on the Wattmann filter paper. Now, once you draw the line, you can label the spots, like indicating what is a sample you have, we are going to spot on the paper. So this is the first step of your experiment. Coming to the next step, spotting of the sample. So approximately you can spot 2 microliter of the corresponding base or mixture of bases. If you are having the samples containing mixture of bases, we can do that one with the help of a capillary tube or a micropipette. Now, when you are doing the spotting, generally a small information to all the students is that the diameter of the spot which we are going to spot should not exceed 5 millimeters. Smaller the spot, better will be the resolution of the separated spotted sample. So see that the spot is going to be smaller, approximately 5 millimeter in diameter on the markings. After spotting, just allow the sample to dry, and you can use a normal air, that is open air, to dry the samples, or by using a hair dryer, you can just pass a stream of hot air on top of your sample for the drying of it. Okay, once that is all over, we are going to start with the experiment. So before starting with the chromatography or development of the chromatography paper, first thing is you have to prepare the mobile phase. So what is the mobile phase we are using? Isopropanol, water, concentrated HCl. What is the ratio in which we are preparing this one? 13 ml is to 3.7 ml is to 3.3 ml. so this is the ratio in which you are preparing the mobile phase. So once you prepare the mobile phase, so whichever is your chamber, chromatographic chamber, and for today's experiment we are going to use the measuring cylinder. So fill the lower region of the measuring cylinder with good amount of the mobile phase and cover it on the top with the lid and keep it aside for some time. So when you do this step of keeping it aside for 5 or 10 or 20 minutes, then there will be complete saturation of the chromatographic chamber with the mobile phase, whatever we have taken inside. So this is another step which you have to perform. So you have taken the paper, you have cut according to the required dimensions, you have made all the necessary markings on it, you have prepared your samples, you have prepared even your mobile phase. So now we are going to start with the process. That means take the Wattmann paper, do the spotting of your samples. Then after drying, place the paper in the chromatographic chamber that is previously saturated with the mobile phase and allow the chromatograph to develop. While placing the Wattmann filter paper in the chamber, take care that the spots are kept at a distance of about 1 centimeter above the solvent. So this is also very, very important. So when you're keeping paper into the chamber, make sure that the spotted area is always above the line where you have kept the spotting of your sample. Otherwise, if it is below, the moment you keep it inside the chamber, the sample will get dissolved or it will get diluted within your mobile phase. So make a point that the spotted area must be always above the solvent. Okay. After the mobile phase has reached the other end of the paper, like say about 0.5 centimeter, remove the paper from the chromatographic chamber. Then immediately mark the distance traveled by the solvent with a pencil, and that line what you're drawing is going to be the measurement used for the solvent front, and that is what we're going to use it for our RF value calculation. Okay, now coming to the last step, detection. After drying, visualize the spots under a UV lamp using a UV trans illuminator. So once you have seen the spots, draw a circle around each spot with a pencil and measure the distance traveled by the solvent front and individual base from the origin, that means from the center of the spot. Then calculate the RF values with the formula given below. Then compare the RF of the unknown bases with those of the standard in the mixture and determine the base that is present in this test sample. So what is the equation for the RF value calculation? That is a distance traveled by the nitrogenous base, which is in centimeter, divided by distance traveled by the solvent. It is what we have labeled earlier as solvent front. Okay, so distance traveled by the solute, in general equation we write it as distance traveled by the solute, but here your solute or analyte is which one? Nitrogenous bases. So that's why I have mentioned here as a nitrogenous bases, and it must be represented only in centimeter. Then distance traveled by the solvent, that also must be in only centimeter. So when you use this equation, you can find out the RF value, relative factor or retardation factor, with which you are able to understand what is the sample that is present in your mixture. Okay, then once you are finished calculating everything, you can report your result. The separated bases, either the pyrimidines or the purines, were found to be so and so. And if you can calculate the RF values, you can mention the RF values also. So that these are the aim, principle, procedure, result for this particular experiment. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So any doubts you have, you can ask me.
We are going to start. So these are the components that we require. So already I am taking two machine symbols. As you know, the diameter is too small. So when I keep the paper inside, you cannot spot many number of samples. So that is the reason why I am going to use two set of the machine cylinder. Now, this is the chamber. The machine cylinder is going to be a chamber for our experiment. As you know that the machine cylinder, what we are using, has to be powered after you have prepared and pouring the mobile case into it. So you have to power it so that you can undergo saturation. We have to saturate the chamber with the mobile case. So we can use the plates now. So what is the mobile case we use for today's experiment? It is the isopropanol 13 ml, then we use water, going to be multiply all the volumes with into five. That makes your process very easy. You just multiply into five, you will get the approximate volume what you require. So this is the isopropanol what I have taken. So first let me transfer it into the beaker which I have already done the by two. So I'm just transferring the 5 ml of the isopropanol. So this is the first solvent what we have used here. So it is propane 2-ol. So it, you know that it is an organic solvent. I cannot keep it open for a long time. So I'm going to cover it with the lid first. Next one is what? Distilled water. So how much amount of distilled water you want? 3.7. So just multiply it with 5. It comes to 18 ml. So I'm just taking 18 ml of the solvent. So that is 18 ml. So I'm going to add to it. That is the second component for the mobile phase mixture to be prepared. Okay? Okay. Done with this one. After adding the water, next thing is the concentrated HCl. So this approximately 16.5 or 17 ml we have to take. It is actually cleaning HCl. So when you are taking it, please keep it away from your face and the nose. So since we have wore the mask, I'm just keeping it maximum away from my face and I need approximately 70 minutes. I have added. So it is cleaning HCl. Even though I have the mask, I can sense the HCl smell. So I'm just transferring it with the water and isopropanol which I have taken earlier. So just along the side. Very slowly to add. Rubber band petrobelosine. So then the creation. Okay, so once you have added it, you have to make the solution homogeneous, is it not? So you have to mix it. Because it's an organic solvent, water, as well as the HCl, concentrate HCl, is it not? So you just mix it thoroughly so that all the three solvents mix properly. So once I have done with this step, now I'm going to transfer some amount of this mobile phase into one measuring cylinder and the other one into the other measuring cylinder. So once it is done, I'm not going to measure approximately since the mark is already there. I am going to add to that mark. That's all. Okay. So why did I do this one as here? My first step is because you have to saturate the chamber with the mobile phase. So that's the reason why I have prepared the mobile phase first and I have taken into the chromatographic chamber. And for today's experiment, chromatographic chamber, what you are taking is the mixing cylinder. Because there should be sufficient time for your sample to move. So a long distance it has to move. So there will be two forces acting on the sample. So what are the two forces that are going to act on the sample? One will be the capillary force. The solvent will be absorbed and it will be pushing the sample to move up. But there is an opposite force acting on it, that is the gravitational force. So if you try to pull it down, so two forces are acting against. So with that force, the sample has to move through the chamber and get separated. And that is the advantage of your ascending paper chromatography. So what we are doing is ascending paper chromatography, and also it is one dimensional paper chromatography. Now, when two forces are acting, separation becomes better in the case of the ascending paper chromatography. Whereas in the case of distillery, there is only one force acting, gravitational force. So the movement will be faster, separation will be faster, but resolution will be poor in that one. Okay, so we have kept it for separating the chamber. Now we have to prepare the sample. So we are going to take adenine, guanine. These are two. What type of bases? 39 and 49. What type of bases?
Purine.
So they are going to be the purine bases. The other ones are phytosine, uracil, which we use it for the pyrimidine bases. So since the volume in which you have to prepare the perchlorate chloric acid is only 1 ml, so we have to prepare the perchloric acid. As you know, perchloric acid, what is the concentration of perchloric we have to prepare? It is 70%. So if it is 70%, it means that you have to take 70 ml of perchloric acid and add 30 ml of the water to it. But the total volume will become 100 ml. That's absolutely fine. Good. But for our experiment, 100 ml is not sufficient. I mean, it's too much. It's too high because we have to add only 1 ml to all the two. So what we'll do is that we'll prepare it in less volume. So you can take 7 ml of the perchloric acid and take 3 ml of the distilled water and prepare only for 10 ml. So 4 bases, 4 ml. This is the stock. Then from that stock, you're going to dilute it. So again, another 4 ml will be required. So 4 plus 4, 8 ml, but we are preparing it for 10 ml. So I think that will be sufficient for us to prepare the perchloric acid. So this also perchloric acid, like all the other acids, is a little bit corrosive. So you have to be handling it with a lot of care when you are preparing it and using it for the experiment. So there are 10 ml machine. So what is the stationary phase? Can anyone tell me? Yes, children, what is the stationary phase? I hope I am audible.
Water, ma'am.
What is the stationary phase?
Water on the paper, ma'am.
Madam, I could mute.
Water on the paper. That's perfect. So what type of chromatography technique is it? Is it liquid-liquid chromatography?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
They are telling it, but it is not audible.
So I'm preparing the perchloric acid. Shivani, just tell me whether you are able to hear what I'm speaking.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am, that's fine. Okay. So this is perchloric acid. As I told you, it is also highly toxic and corrosive, so you have to handle with care. Since we require only 7 ml, I am just using this measuring cylinder to measure it. So I label it so that we don't get confused. So this is the perchloric acid. Because we know that they all are bases, so they don't get easily solubilized in water. You can use water also, but you have to warm the solution many number of times to make them highly get solubilized. So as per the protocol in one of the textbooks which we are referring, they are giving perchloric acid 70%. So I'll just dilute it. So I have taken perchloric acid 7 ml. So I'm just adding along the sides of the beaker. So how much ml water I should add to this one? I should
3
add 3 ml of the water. So I just use a pipette. So I'm adding 1 ml. This is 2 ml. And this is 3 ml. So 7 ml of perchloric acid and 3 ml of the water. So that makes us the 70% of the perchloric acid. So total volume what we have prepared is only 10 ml. Not to waste the solution, to be a little bit hot because it's an acid, they will liberate the heat. So I'm just mixing it. So with this also, we keep it aside. We have to weigh the bases. So 10 milligram. That is the top standard concentration, 10 milligram per ml. So we have to prepare all the bases. So I'll just label the ependrop tube. So we're weighing, it becomes PC for us. What is the stock standard concentration I told you? It is 10 milligram per ml. Okay. Then what is the dilution? How are we going to do the dilution? What is the concentration of the diluted sample? Yes, concentration is 1 milligram per ml. So you have to dilute it, because concentration also plays a very important role in the separation. If your sample is too highly concentrated, they will not be able to move on the paper. So that's why you have to be very careful even with this concentration. So this is cytosine, and I label this as uracil. So we will weigh the substance.
Yes. Switch on. Weighing
So we will weigh the substance 10 milligram. So I'm using Dona balance so that we can determine the correct concentration. So I'll just stick it on. It's the paper weight. So it is 12. I'm just making it to 12.
Okay. So I'll add the substance now. So first one, what I've taken is adenine.
So 12 to come to 13. That tells us it will be only 10 milligram of the 15.
Of adenine. So 12 it has reached to 13. So whatever is the concentration given, it's always better you go with that concentration to get the better. Okay. You can just take it. This is adenine. I've already labeled the ependrop tube. So this is adenine. So in that I'm transferring the contents. So they are all nitrogenous bases. I told you they will not get solubilized in water. So you can see the substance is there. That's the 10 milligram of the substance. So we have to dissolve it only in perchloric acid. It may take some time to dissolve. The next one will go with guanine. We are going first to the urine base.
Switch it on.
So it is showing to me in between 16 and 17. So I have to just adjust to any one number. So I've kept this 160 milligram. It is, that's the weight of the paper. So now we have to add the
16
to 17. A little bit excess is there. So we can remove it. One of the advantage of all these chromatography techniques is that you're not dependent on current for the experiment. So weighing all it is required, but to do the experiment, we don't require the current, only for weighing or measuring it. And they come in batches. So this is the guanine substance. We have prepared to this is the rascal. So all the bases have to be prepared at a concentration of 10 milligrams per ml. This is stock standard what we are preparing with 10 milligrams. We are just going to take only 2 microliters, is it not? So it is too less. So we can prepare it once, put it in the freezer, and whenever we want it, we can start to use the paper. It is already in 70, so I'm just adding to something 80. Okay, so what is the base we have taken now? It is uracil U. So I'm just adding in the ependrosio U. I'm always changing the paper. You cannot use the same paper, is it not? Because it should be absolutely pure. Otherwise, when you are doing the experiment, you will be getting 2-3 spots in the same sample. So that will result in some error. So it is showing me 1414. Okay, so I have to wait till 15. That becomes 10 minutes. So we have prepared, we have weighed all the bases. Here, what we are supposed to do is now dissolve them only in perchloric acid. So we have prepared already that one also. We will add 1 ml to each of the chondrocube and we will dissolve. Except guanine, all the other substances we will break out very quickly. Guanine is important because of our time, but let us see. If other bases are dissolved, we try to dilute them and do the spot. So this is the perchloric acid. When I added water, it was a little bit hot. It became a little bit chill. So I opened all the ependrosiums. Take it and add. This is 39 for the label what I've written. C, so it is cytosine. And the other one is guanine. So I'm just placing it because we'll be using it again. So you can see it should get dissolved enough. It will take some time. You'll see how this takes. Cytosine will get dissolved, not an issue. Little bit of fixing is required. So you can see most it has got dissolved. So what we will do is that by the time it could get dissolved, we will start to take the measurement for the paper and then
for the paper, so that by the time it will get dissolved and it will be ready for dilution. Okay. Arinine has got this one. We then do next. Okay, students, so we are going to now go with the next part of the experiment preparing, that is the Hoffman filter paper. So as you all know that Hoffman filter paper should be handled with lot amount of care, is it not? So I'll just make the paper plate ready for it. Okay, so I have to use the gloves, even though for pyrimidines and purines, they may not interfere with the result, but when these papers are used for amino acids and similar experiments, they may interfere with the result. Not only doing chromatography, the chromatogram. Once the experiment is over, the paper is going to be called as a chromatogram. Dropping chromatogram must be good enough with the proper spot on top of it. So that's the reason why you're going to use it. Now, I told you this is the chamber what we are going to use, it is not. So I have to measure its diameter and also the length of it. So that based on that, I can cut the paper. So I'm just using a small scale to measure. So this is 15. So that becomes 30. And from here, it becomes close to 6. It is showing me. So it is 36 centimeters. But generally what we do is that we allow some paper to be hanging on the other side also. So I will make it as 56 plus 10. Make it as 40 or 42 centimeters to be the height. I'm going to overhang the paper outside because it has to hang for 24 hours. Now the diameter and I say it is approximately 5.5. If you measure 5.5 with the paper, it will not go inside. So better to go with 4.5 centimeters. Okay? So that will be better. So that is the measurement what I have done now. So we will do with go with the paper cutting. So you know this Hoffman paper. Why these papers are so special? Why you are not using your normal paper? Why are you using only Hoffman filter paper for these experiments? Anyone is answering?
Presence of cellulose.
Someone is answering. That is why we are using only
endosmos of cellulose.
Okay, capturing the most often. So it has to be the paper quality is very important with the separation. So the percentage of cellulose that is present in these papers are perfect, which will allow proper separation of the sample. Okay. So I feel this side would be better for us to take it. So I'll just measure with the scale. So I'm just measuring. I said 4.5, so I'll just measure 4.5 here. Just be very gentle on the paper, okay? So only I want 4.5 so that I don't make any cross cutting here and here. A few distance I'm marking so that I get a proper line, straight line, rather than wasting the paper here and there. Okay? So now I'll join them. So I thought I'm going with 42 centimeters. So I'll join the first 4.5. So this has become more. This has become more to 30. 15 to 15, it has become to 30. 30, 37 mm. 37 is 40. That must be enough. Okay, so now this The length is very good over here in this paper. So I'm going ahead with that one only. So another one more paper we want. So I'm just marking the 4.5 distance everywhere. So this is again 4.5. Then again 4.5. Then again 4.5. So now I'll join them and just cut the paste. So I finished drawing it. The papers what we are getting, I told it can be, it will be prepared from wood or from cotton, because cotton contains 96% of cellulose. So that percentage will give a good quality paper, and also the pore size and the thickness of the paper with which we are preparing will give a better result. I to do sorting and then place it something. Carry on. Will come. No problem.
Pardon, now place for them. Once I cut the paper, it's better that I replace the remaining piece of paper back into its place and cover it up. Yes, are you all watching what I'm doing?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Paper, you know, it's coming from you, but after my first only, better always to be safe while you are handling it. And careful with it, okay? Just cut the other piece also. What is the next step after measuring the dimensions and cutting the paper? You're going to mark the lines. You're going to draw a line. In the protocol, it is given 1 or 1.5 centimeter. If your measuring chamber is just a beaker, then 1 to 1.5 centimeter is okay. But since it is a measuring cylinder, you will increase the length. The length. So it's a very, very small strip, it is. Okay. So what are the bases I have measured? I think you must have seen it. So approximately, I'm putting it as 4 centimeters, children, because it is the volume is also 5 here. So it is 2.5 to close to 3 it is. So it's better I put 4 or 4.5. So I just draw a line. Okay. Then one paper we use for purines, another paper we use it for the pyramidines. Equidistance is given, so measure both from both the ends and you just mark a spot. That is the place indicating where you are going to do the spotting of the sample. So I will write adenine and guanine. So this is the first paper. This next paper also. You just take 4 to 5 centimeters.
the height of the solvent is high in the methane cylinder.
So 10 more minutes.
So by the time we will do the next step, you see we have dissolved all the bases. They all have got dissolved now. Okay. So this is cytosol. Everything has got dissolved in the perchloric acid. Remember, perchloric acid. 20% we have to get. Okay. What is the next step we are supposed to do? We are supposed to dilute it. This is the top standard, is it not? So we are supposed to dilute it. So we put all label as diluted, so it is dilute adenine. The next is dilute guanine. The next is dilute cytosine. Next is okay, so now what we are going to do is that we will change the volume. Perchloric acid is here. So I will reduce the volume to 9 because we will take from the stock 0.1 ml and you have to make it up to 1 ml. Is it not? 0.1 ml if it is, it has 0.9 ml of the perchloric acid. So I will make it as 900 microliter. Okay, so first thing what I will do is that I will take the perchloric acid solution in the Eppendorf tube. So I am adding 900 microliter. Okay, children, so I have taken the perchloric acid and just putting it aside. Now we have to take the sample. So, Okay, so this is 100. And when we are doing it, let us use separate tip for each and every sample. Okay? Because we cannot contaminate them. So this is adenine. So we will take the adenine tube. This is uracil. This is cytosine. This is guanine. So this first is adenine. Okay, so from here I'm taking 0.1 ml of the adenine and adding it to 0.9 ml of the perchloric acid. So just mix it and dissolve the tip. Okay. Mix it properly, okay, and then just put it aside. Now next one is guanine. This is 0.1 ml. This is guanine sample. So add it in the guanine. This is guanine. This will mix it a little bit. Okay, we'll add the last one, that is cytosine.
0.1 ml I'm adding it. I hope you are able to observe it. So this is cyclosine. We are spotting it, you should be very careful, children, because it is perchloric acid. So perchloric acid has a chance of eating away the paper also. So when you are doing it, be very careful while you are doing the spotting and drying of the sample. Put the stop hand and place it aside. So we are ready with all the samples. So this is uracil. This is cytosine. So these two are pyrimidines. So we use a capillary tube. So since we have four samples, we can use four different capillary tubes. At present, I'm putting it only in two. So the first one is uracil. So you have the uracil on this paper here. Just see, what must be the size? I told it must be only 5 mm. Just touch the paper. That's it. Leave it up. Okay. Similarly, you're going to take cytosine. Just take a small eyedrop. Okay. Allow it to dry. The sample spotting must dry thoroughly. Then only you will get good separation and resolution of the spot. So this is guanine and this is adenine. So guanine, let us take the spot, put it on guanine, 5 mm, very small spot, enough, that is enough what I spotted. Smaller the spot, better the separation and resolution of the sample. So that's all. So first spotting is over, we just leave it aside for few minutes. So once it has been dried up, we can put the second spot. This is only to intensify the concentration. Because sometimes if the drop is very small, maybe the concentration what you spotted may not be sufficient. So that's the reason why we do the second spotting also. So if once it is over, if the paper has been completely thoroughly dried, then we can put it into the chamber. Okay. So as far as, shall we do the second spotting? So this is guanine. So I'll just put a spot on guanine. Just second time I'm spotting it. Please spot it for the second time on the same place. Then the otherwise the result will vary. Okay. Then this is uracil. Then this is cytosine. That's it. I finished with the spotting, putting the sample aside. Keep everything aside. So we have kept already the chamber for saturation, is it not? So it must be saturated with the mobile phase. Solved. Now we have to make setup things ready for the this one, is it not? So what we will do is that I will try one method. Let us see if it is going to work out.
This is done.
Maybe I'll keep it. Now
I'm going to place the paper inside. Okay. And there is a fold inside. I'm just trying to stretch it. Just immerse it.
So you can see the spotted areas very much above the solvent. Okay. So you can see it is traveling.
So what we will do is that we'll just fold the paper. And put the rubber band on it. One we have done, just covering it. So I think it has started to move. So evening I'll make a check of it and then see the movement properly. Okay. Now the next paper also we shall insert it.
ఇంకా ఫోల్డ్ చేస్తా మేడం అంతా మొత్తము ఫోల్డ్ చేస్తా
So we have placed other than also inside. Right, the spotted area is above the solvent. That also is very important. So I'm just covering it and leave them undisturbed. Okay. So you can see here the solvent has already moved in a good distance, but it has not still touched the sample. Here also we have kept. It has started to move, so it will start to move some more distance. Okay, so this we have to keep it for nearly 24 hours. Next, we have to paper and then dry it, and then we have to get it to the okay. doubt you have, you can ask regarding the experiment. Any doubt? If I have a doubt, I'll put it in front of you, think about it, and tell me the answer. Yes? The question is, you are going to remove the paper. Okay? I told you, I'm going to place it in the black color corner will be visible. When you keep the paper inside the chamber, spots are visible. You remove the paper outside, spots are not visible. So how you measure the distance then? That is the question for you. So how I am going to calculate the RF value? But I gave you the equation. It means that you can calculate it. So there is a technique in order to identify the spot, locate the spot, and then measure the distance. So there is a strategy to do that one. So anybody is getting the answer, you can tell. Okay? Yes, children.
No.